When a T cell encounters an antigen-presenting cell, it moves its centrosome to the immunological synapse connecting the two cells in order to direct the secretion of effector molecules toward their target. Centrosome repositioning is thought to be driven by a cortical sliding mechanism, in which dynein motors anchored at the periphery of the immunological synapse pull on microtubules emanating from the centrosome. But John Hammer from the National Heart, Lung and Blood Institute in Bethesda, Maryland, wanted to take a closer look at the process.
There had been some very beautiful work looking at centrosome positioning in T cells, but a lot of the work was very static in nature. That is, the T cell and the target were mixed together. There was a period of time, and then they were fixed, and people would stain and score how close the centrosome was to the synapse. This approach doesn't give you any dynamic information, and it has a high background because the interaction of the T cell and the target cells is stochastic. The real key, I think, to getting the project going and allowing us to do what we did was to build an optical trap on our spinning disk microscope so we could control temporally and spatially the presentation of the target cell to the T cell. We could bring the target cell always 180 degrees opposite from the position of the centrosome, allowing us to watch from the moment of initial contact between the two cells the whole dynamic process of centrosome repositioning.
Previous studies have suggested that signaling by the T cell receptor is sufficient to recruit centrosomes to the immunological synapse, and that integrin and calcium-based signaling are not required for centrosome repositioning. Hammer and colleagues, led by Jason Yi, tested this idea by comparing centrosome recruitment in various T cell lines under different conditions.
Using our approach, which we thought was fairly quantitative, we showed that in order to get robust repositioning of the centrosome, you really need all three of these components: the T cell receptor engagement, the engagement of the integrin LFA1, and intracellular calcium flux.
Yi et al. Then followed the dynamics of centrosome repositioning by live imaging T cells expressing fluorescent markers of the centrosome and the plasma membrane.
Previous studies had suggested that the centrosome repositions at a single speed of about 3 microns per minute. When we applied our approach, what we found is that the centrosome does come over at about 3 microns per minute for about 3/4 of the trip, what we call the polarization phase. But when it gets within about 2 to 2.5 microns from the synaptic membrane, it then slows down and then slowly approaches the synapse. And we call that the docking phase. And so we concluded from our initial studies of the kinetics of centrosome positioning that it was actually a biphasic process.
Sometimes, however, a centrosome would appear to get stuck behind the T cell's nucleus.
And then what you see is really quite amazing. The entire synaptic membrane invaginates in an effort to reach to the centrosome. So in other words, if the centrosome can't come to the synaptic membrane comes to the centrosome. And what was perhaps very telling was that it is the center of the synapse which invaginates, not the periphery where people thought the force generator was localized. And this suggested to us that dynein, which was the likely force generator, was focused at the middle of the synapse and not at its periphery.
Dynein's localization to the center of the immunological synapse would be inconsistent with the cortical sliding mechanism of centrosome repositioning. However, it would be compatible with a different mode of centrosome movement called the capture shrinkage mechanism, in which cortical dynein binds end-on to a microtubule plus end and pulls the centrosome towards it through a combination of its motor activity and the force of microtubule depolymerization. Yi et al. Therefore examined the dynamics of T-cell microtubules during centrosome repositioning.
What we saw is that early in the process, a number of microtubules would attach in end-on fashion right in the center of the synapse, would be pulled straight into a stalk or bundle running from the centrosome to approximately the center of the synapse. And then with the same kinetics and time courses we saw in the earlier part of the study, we see this stalk shorten and bring the centrosome to the synaptic membrane. And this would be consistent not with a peripheral cortical sliding mechanism as previously thought, but rather with this end-on capture shrinkage mechanism where the stepping of the dynein and the depolymerization of the microtubule are mechanistically coupled in order to draw the centrosome over.
Ye et al. Therefore reasoned that centrosome repositioning should be blocked by inhibitors of dynein and microtubule depolymerization.
In the case of dynein, we used a new small molecule membrane permeant inhibitor cytoplasmic dynein called ciliobrevin. Using that, what we found is that there is a dramatic reduction in the efficiency of centrosome repositioning, a threefold reduction in the rate at which the centrosome approaches the synapse, and a complete block in this second docking phase. So it comes over very slowly, and when it gets about 2 microns from the synaptic membrane, it just completely stalls and progresses no further.
To inhibit microtubule depolymerization, the researchers used an intermediate concentration of Taxol that stabilized microtubules without inducing filament bundling.
And what we found is that the process, again, is slowed greatly, and the overall efficiency of centrosome repositioning is greatly reduced. It does come over, but very slowly. When we simultaneously inhibit dynein with ciliobrevin and microtubule depolymerization with Taxol, we get a complete and total block in centrosome repositioning. And so basically, we think this process is dynein-dependent and microtubule depolymerization-dependent, which is consistent with the end-on capture shrinkage mechanism.
Hammer doesn't rule out a limited role for cortical microtubule sliding, but the capture shrinkage mechanism probably allows T cells to reposition their centrosomes with greater efficiency and reproducibility. So what do the researchers plan to investigate next?
So I think questions that are interesting would be, how is cytoplasmic dynein attached to the synaptic membrane? How is this attachment initiated and regulated? What other molecules, accessory molecules, are involved in the process? And then how is centrosome repositioning coordinated temporally with the formation of the immunological synapse, and perhaps more importantly, the delivery of granules containing lytic components or cytokines?
In the meantime, you can learn more about how T cells reposition their centrosomes through a biphasic process driven by microtubule end-on capture shrinkage in the paper by Ye et al., published in the September 2, 2013 issue of the Journal of Cell Biology. Thank you.